Hola a todos, hoy vamos a tener una sesión llamada Hackeando Apex, donde vamos a ver todas las amenazas a la seguridad que se pueden presentar cuando utilizamos las aplicaciones de Apex y cómo se pueden prevenir. Antes de eso, voy a contarles algunas noticias que tenemos. Como ustedes, si estuvieron en el Meetup anterior, se dieron cuenta que el Meetup Apex Latinoamérica va a migrar a Meetup Apex en Colombia. Y el Meetup de Apex en Colombia, pues vamos a cambiarle el nombre para ponerlo un poco más general y que abarque toda Latinoamérica. ¿Listo? Este Meetup de Apex Latinoamérica va a estar disponible hasta el 28 de diciembre. Y ya después simplemente se va a cerrar el grupo. Entonces, para que por favor los que quieran continuar estando al tanto de Apex, entonces se inscriban en el Meetup de Apex Colombia para que no se pierdan entonces de todos los webinars. No sé si han visto también, yo creé un sticker para el Meetup de Apex Colombia. Bueno, después me tocará crear otro. Para Latinoamérica, que se puede utilizar, pues, como ustedes ven en el computador, o lo pueden pegar en cualquier parte que ustedes quieran. Las personas que están en Cali, podemos cuadrar para regalarles a cada uno el sticker. Listo, empecemos entonces con la presentación de hoy. Nuestro presentador es Dan Magán. Él es Oracle Developer Advocate con enfoque en JavaScript y la base de datos Oracle. Y arrancó su carrera utilizando MySQL y PHP. Luego, felizmente, encontró a Oracle Application Express y desde entonces ha dedicado sus esfuerzos de programación a aprender más sobre Oracle y las tecnologías basadas en web en general. Pueden encontrar su blog. Aquí les dejo el link para que puedan acceder a toda la información que publica Dan. Listo. Entonces ahora le voy a dar el control a Dan.
Gracias, Clarisa. Voy a
Clarice.
compartir todo. Bueno, gracias
Mónica.
por tenerme. Voy a empezar en español, pero solamente para saludarles, decir hola. Pero bueno, tengo mucho tiempo sin practicar mi español, especialmente para hacer una presentación técnica como esa. Entonces voy a cambiar al español, pero si alguien tiene una pregunta o quieren decir algo, ¿pueden hablar Clarisa o no? ¿O Mónica o no?
Sí, claro, pueden hablar en cualquier momento o escribir
Okay.
la pregunta.
Perfecto, perfecto. Tenemos una grupa, alguien tiene un eco. Tenemos una grupa muy pequeña, entonces yo pienso que será bueno o bien si tienen preguntas, bueno, pregúntame y lo puedo contestar inmediatamente. Ok, bueno, vamos a empezar. ¿Todos pueden ver mi screen?
Sí, se ve perfecto.
Ok. Bueno, pues. No tengo, I don't have any slides. I'm just gonna go straight into demo. I will do my best to speak very slowly, but if I forget, as I sometimes do, just remind me to slow down. All right, so we'll start just going right into demo and skip any kind of slides you might normally see in a presentation like this. So what I have here is a very, very basic Apex application, and I created this application to demonstrate to you how security vulnerabilities can creep up in your applications. But I have to say, I had to go out of my way Okay. It was difficult for me to create this application. So keep that in mind. I should say that Apex is secure by default these days. However, as you use Apex more and more, you will find one of two things can happen. Either one, you are maintaining an application that is kind of old. Maybe you didn't write it, but now you have to maintain it. And it was written in a time before Apex was secure by default. So that's one situation you could be in. The other situation you could fall into is you're creating an application that is rather sophisticated, right? We all know that Apex can create very simple applications and very complex applications. And when you move over to the more complex side of things, these security vulnerabilities can start to appear in your applications. All right. So let's talk about the first of two types of vulnerabilities we'll be looking at today.
Dan,
the first, yes,
Dan,
all right.
Me gustaría, I would like to just mention in Spanish some the very key point here, that is that you unsecure things to make this happen. ¿No?
Yes.
En español.
Bueno.
Quiero nada más explicarles que la demostración que Dan va a hacer, él tuvo que hacer cambios en la seguridad de la aplicación para habilitar los problemas que nos va a mostrar. Queremos nada más que quede muy en claro que Apex tiene unos parámetros de seguridad muy buenos últimamente en la nueva versión. Se hace lo posible porque la aplicación sea muy segura. Y Dan cambió varios valores para reducir el nivel de seguridad. Ahora, es importante que entiendan que como es posible reducir esos niveles de seguridad, él dice, quizás es también una aplicación vieja que se ha ido cambiando de versión, pero mantuvo el nivel de seguridad bajo, o algún desarrollador no entiende lo que el parámetro hace y a veces lo cambiamos y no sabemos las ramificaciones que ese cambio puede tener. Entonces, solo quería explicar eso. Continúa, Dan.
Okay, and we can speak a little bit more about that as we go, more detailed. So let's start here, where we have a report, and if we look at the source for the report, we'll see a basic query, which is select star from emp. But I'm saying where job is not in president or manager. And so the idea is we're trying to prevent the user of the application from being able to manipulate employees with these job titles. So when we run this, when we look at job, we don't see any of those employees. But it's not terribly hard to break this. So let's say a user clicks on Scott, and they go up into the URL, and they see this kind of weird setting here, right? And if they hit cancel, and then they go look at Ford, which has 7902, they know now that what is really happening in the URL is the employee ID is being used. And as you use Apex over time, you'll learn that there are 9 different positions in an Apex URL, starting with the application ID, then the page ID, then the session ID, and eventually you get to positions 7 and 8, which correlate to item names. Position 8 is item values. So if you know a value, such as the ID of somebody with one of these other jobs, like 7839, then you'll see that you can, in fact, get to a job that wasn't displayed in the report. And so the idea here is, how do we prevent this from happening? The way we would do that is with something we call session state protection within Apex, and I'll just sort of explain that very briefly here. So you have in a custom schema maybe a table called emp, and that's the table that has the actual values. In another schema, we'll make this one custom. In another schema, you might have the Apex schema. And in this, there are two tables. One is called sessions, and the other, let's call it item values. So I can make this a little bit bigger. The way that this works is, the way Apex works is when you are manipulating values in the web page, which is a third place values can exist. So when we look at this web page here, what we're seeing is this, the DOM. And the values need to go from the DOM when we make a change like that into this table. But in order to get to this table, they go through this table right here. And you can think of this as like a go-between or a middleman. They have to go through it to get to one or the other. Okay? So when we talk about session state protection, this is what we're protecting right here. Okay? So what we have in Apex to prevent the technique I just used, which is URL manipulation, we have session state protection settings at the page level. So if I come in and look at the page properties and scroll down on the right until I see security, here you'll see page access protection. And you'll note that there are four different values, and the first, the current value, is the least secure. It's completely unrestricted. And there are other values here. Arguments must have a checksum is usually what people are going to use to leverage this security here. Now, if I set that and I hit save, and now we go back to the report page, and then go back clicking on an edit button, you'll now notice that there's a checksum value in the URL. And so the way that Apex works, when it generates the links, it looks at the destination page and says, hey, does this page have session state protection enabled? If so, I will go ahead then and generate a checksum. So we see that here, and you think, well, obviously this is good, right? It will protect the user. So if we do, what was it, 7038, something like that. If you manipulate the value now, this value does not match the value that was used to produce the checksum. So Apex will give us an error. And we think this is more secure, right? Or hey, just to be sure, are you planning on doing more translations, or shall I just keep going?
Solo si tú me pides algo. Si es por ayuda o alguna pregunta.
Hold on, let me mute somebody. I don't have control. Can someone mute Arturo?
Ya.
Perfecto. Okay.
No, si quería hacerles un comentario acerca de lo que habló Dan. ¿Me escuchan?
Sí.
Okay. Bueno, Dan nos estaba explicando inicialmente aquí en la parte de donde está la URL, porque todos ya conocen la sintaxis o los parámetros que debe recibir esta URL, y lo que estábamos viendo principalmente es que nosotros podemos ver, y los usuarios también van a poder ver, dónde se está recibiendo el código, en este caso del empleado. Entonces, después de que está el parámetro P11 externo, viene este valor, y si yo quisiera ir directamente a modificar los votos de otro ID, por ejemplo, al que no tuviera acceso, yo llevo ese cambio a este ID y pudiera ver toda la información de ese empleado. Esto solamente se puede hacer si tenemos la restricción más baja, en el cual no revisa si se cambia este ID. Pero con el cambio que hizo Adán, para que valide el checksum, entonces allí, y si nosotros tratamos de hacer un cambio, él no lo va a permitir, porque ese checksum está generado basado en la información que tenía la URL inicialmente. ¿Listo? Esa es digamos que una amenaza que a la que nos vemos bastante, digamos, comprometidos si no tenemos en cuenta eso. Por lo general, las páginas todas tienen una restricción, pero si le quitamos esa restricción, entonces van a quedar así completamente disponibles para que el usuario pueda cambiar y modificar la URL. Bueno, Dan habló varias cosas. No sé si hasta allí todos han entendido bien o tienen alguna pregunta.
Bueno.
Eso mismo aplica cuando se estudia la página sin esa opción, pero si el campo tiene la opción.
¿Mónica?
Uh-huh.
Hola, Mónica, con César.
Hola.
Hola, Mónica. Una cosa. Cuando tenemos un formulario y queremos hacer cálculos con algunos campos, siempre nos presenta el problema cuando vamos a otro lado a consultar una información y regresamos con esa información. Este checksum dificulta bastante algunas operaciones porque no deja reemplazar el valor que trae. ¿Estamos hablando de lo mismo? ¿Por defecto él va a proteger el campo? ¿O hay alguna manera que sin perder la seguridad podamos manipular más el campo? Porque de pronto a uno le toca quitar la seguridad del campo, digamos, para poder hacer operaciones como retornar, ir a buscar algo en otro lado y devolver ese valor a la página en la que estás trabajando, o hacer algún cálculo. Sencillamente no te deja, te dice que hay una protección y no te deja reemplazar el valor existente y se enreda un poquito los cálculos. ¿Y qué podemos hacer para nosotros? Hacer cálculos sin perder la seguridad.
Dan, you got that? Maybe? Sort of.
I got he's a doing lot a of it.
So
yeah,
he's on a form,
on.
He's doing a lookup, brings a value back. The checksum will stop him. César, me gustaría preguntar qué tipo de cálculos. ¿Estás nada más buscando otro dato y trayendo el resultado? ¿O estás haciendo alguna manipulación de datos?
Veamos un caso, por decir algo. Tienes el valor del ítem, el usuario digita la cantidad y tú quieres calcular cantidad por total. Por poner un ejemplo, en algunos casos sencillamente no permite hacer esa operación, o cuando vas a traer información de otro dato y vas a guardar de retorno en ese campo, dice que está protegido y sencillamente no te deja avanzar. Como por defecto trae esa protección del campo cuando estás haciendo cálculos, o vas a retornar de otra página a la que estás usando. Es como si se perdiera la sesión, algo pasa.
Bueno, eso suena un poco diferente, lo de cambiar de página y se pierde la sesión. Eso suena un poco diferente, pero mira, si el campo, si tú esperas que el usuario pueda digitar o meter algún valor, entonces tú no necesitas, entonces es correcto que no tenga esta protección. De hecho, no la va a tener cuando tú puedes meter el dato, pero A mí me parece que a lo mejor estás hablando de algún campo que sea de tipo escondido, ¿no? Un hidden item que a lo mejor estás haciendo para algún cálculo. Ese es el problema. Entonces tú tienes que ahí juzgar según la actividad que estás haciendo. Si tienes un campo escondido, es correcto quitarle la protección al campo escondido siempre y cuando te imagines que sería lo mismo a poner el campo como si fuera un campo de texto donde el usuario puede meter cualquier valor. Si eso no es aceptable, si no es aceptable que el usuario meta cualquier valor, entonces la recomendación sería poner una validación de Apex, donde tú valides que el valor que estás recibiendo, el valor escondido que estás recibiendo, sea aceptable, sean los requerimientos que haga falta. A lo mejor tiene que existir una tabla, a lo mejor tiene que pertenecerle al usuario.
Tenemos un ejemplo de eso más tarde.
Muy bien, muy bien. Sí, entonces, creo que la respuesta es depende. O sea, sí es posible que tú le quites la seguridad, pero tienes que estar consciente, Dan nos va a enseñar ese ejemplo, y tienes que estar consciente de que si tú le quitas la seguridad, tiene ramificaciones, ¿no? Y a lo mejor necesitas otro tipo de validación de seguridad.
Tengo un ejemplo perfecto que de pronto redondea la idea. Disculpa,
vamos a ver el ejemplo. Vamos a ver el ejemplo de Dan para que él siga avanzando y entonces vemos qué tal si tu ejemplo es exacto.
Perfecto, muchas gracias.
Muy bien.
Perfecto. Okay. So remember, what we did is we went into this form page, page 11, and turned on session state protection at the page level, right? So we think we're secure. Let's see, the right employee is 7839. Okay. We think we're secure, but I'll show you why we're not. If I go back to this page where we're setting this to a different employee, and I remove the checksum and clear out some other parameters. Now, I take us instead to page 10, which is the report page. Notice that I didn't necessarily need the checksum. And so if I take this value for King and bring it back, it seems to have worked. And so now, all I need to do is go to page 11, and we're looking again at the president. Okay? So the problem here is that I protected one page in the application, but there are many pages I have not protected. So protecting pages is good, but it's not the most important thing. What is more important is to protect the item, the lower level. To do that, we have a different setting. So I'll go edit the page. And when you think about it, I could protect all of these items, but the most important item is this hidden item here. This is the one you want to protect the most. So if I select that and then scroll down to security, you'll see again we have a similar setting as before, but it's at the item level. So the middle three here mean that a checksum will be required for this item, and it does not matter what page you're navigating to. If you're using the URL to set the value of the item, it must have a checksum in the URL. What makes these different is how long the checksum can be used for. So if you set it here, then the checksum will only be good for one user's session. If you set it here, the same user can log out tomorrow, log back in, and use the same URL, and it will work. We call this a bookmark. And then there's application level. which means I can take a URL, I can email it to you, and you can click the URL in the email, and it will work for you too. So those are the different levels. And we also have completely restricted. You cannot set the value from the browser. In most cases, that could be too secure. So we'll go with session level, save the change. And now when we try the same hack, so let's say we start from here and remove the checksum and remove a few other pieces, change the page to 10 again, and make this whatever we want. Now, Apex is going to stop us. You simply cannot change the item's value from the URL or the browser without a checksum. Really just the browser or the URL. Okay. So this is where you want to be, and I'll show you very briefly. If you look in the shared components under security, you will see session state protection here. Now what this is a listing of what pages and what items are currently protected, but there's also a wizard you can use to set the security for the entire application. But you must be careful because you can usually only use this one time. And then the application is set, it's secure, maybe too secure, and you have to adjust it. But once you adjust it, this wizard is not going to work again. Okay, one last thing on session state protection. So we've seen that you can set the values from the URL, but there's another way. So let's say we go to edit this person now. If they know enough, they know that oftentimes with Apex, this item is in the DOM. So what we can do is find it by inspecting and bringing up your browser's developer tools. And we can then search for P11, oops, empno. And you can see the value is in the DOM. And so if I wanted to I can replace it, and this was King. He's the president. He doesn't have a manager, and his salary is, I believe, $5,000. Let's take this and open a report page. Oh well, we can't see King. Never mind. Well, at any rate, what I'll do is change this to 1,000 and hit apply. And you'll see that we have a success message, even though, you know, certainly nobody we are looking at makes 1,000. But now King is making 1,000. We could verify that going through the back. So here's King now making 1,000. So the way that you protect against this technique using the DOM is a little bit different. Now going back to what we said before about I had to break this, we have this hidden item here. There's another setting under settings called value protected. It was on when I created this item, but I turned it off to show you why this feature exists. So if I turn it back on, save, and rerun, And now we look at the item. Under the item, you'll see something new. And again, you're going to see a checksum. So if we manipulate this value to anything else and then submit it, Apex will prevent that from happening. So hidden and protected means from the time that the page is rendered to the time that the page is submitted, the value of the hidden item must stay the same. So those are the two things you have to know to protect your items and ultimately session state and Apex.
Dan, I have a question.
Yep.
Suppose that you want to change that the number of that item, right? And you want to change the value of the item into a logic. How can I do that? Because many times I get this error, and what I want to do is change the value of the item inside of the logic of the application, which is good, it's normal, but I got this message. What I do is set the value, not protect.
You do what at the very end there?
What I do is change the setting, the value protect, to null.
Ah, sure. That's the easy way out. Potentially also the unsecure way. It really depends on the application. So one thing you could do that would be more secure goes back to what Jorge suggested earlier. And whenever somebody asks a generic question, we unfortunately have to give generic answers. But in this case, I would say, you want to send the user through either the page rendering or the page submission process, and you want to compare the value of the item against a predetermined list or values that you know to be acceptable for the user at the time. So you can loosen the screw, that's okay, as long as you check the value and ensure that it's okay. Does that make sense?
Yes.
And of course, if you have more specific examples, you know, we could even do another session where people bring questions like Cesar, and have maybe they create a demo, and we can talk in more depth about more detailed examples and how to go about solving them. But oftentimes, it's just checking the value. To make sure.
Okay. Okay. We can do that. Thank you, Ben.
Sure. Okay, let's move on to SQL injection. What I have here is an interactive report, and I made it really easy for managers to let their employees know that they're doing a great job. So the way this works, they click the button, and it asks, are you sure they've done a great job? They say, okay, and it says, email sent. Woo, easy, right? So how was this put together? Well, if you look at the page, you'll see the report on employees, and you will see that I have some HTML in my report, and I'm bringing in the employee number into an HTML attribute that will be unique for each row so that I know which button or for which employee the button was clicked. Now, when the button is clicked, a dynamic action will take over from there. And so the first thing it does is confirm. The next thing it does is it takes the value from that HTML attribute, puts it into a variable, and then uses $s, which is a JavaScript function that's been in Apex for a long time, to set the value of an item to the value in the variable. Okay? Once the JavaScript is done, then the PL SQL code that actually sends the email can go. Note that this is a PL SQL process, and it will submit the value of the item that the JavaScript code set. So this process is pretty simple. We declare a row type variable. We then select into this variable from emp, where empno equals the value of the item, and then we use Apex Mail to send the email. Now, the problem here is this. It's the substitution variable syntax that I used to access the value of variables. In SQL and PL SQL code, you should never, ever use this form of substitution string syntax. Starts with an ampersand, ends with a period. It's very dangerous. You should instead use bind variable syntax. But before I switch, I want to show you another tool in Apex that you should be using on a regular basis. I've come to the shared components, and oh, I'm in the wrong place, actually. Let me go to utilities, and then into the advisor. Now, the advisor used to be a completely separate application many years ago. It was written by a guy named Patrick Wolf, and it scans your application metadata to find common problems. So let me remove errors and quality assurance, but in the future, when you use this tool, and you should, everybody, every day, you'll definitely want to fix errors first. These are often the biggest problems. But we're going to focus on security. And notice one of the checks that's coming up is inappropriate use of substitution variable syntax. If I focus on just that, you'll see that it is flagging us, telling us that this is really bad in SQL and in PL SQL code, as well as process table names, which I didn't even know. So there you go. Don't do that there either. So what's the fix? Well, we'll go back to page one, and we'll find our process, and we'll change the syntax to bind variable syntax. And remember, bind variables start with a colon in Oracle. And the nice thing about bind variables in Apex is that Apex does all the technically challenging stuff with binds. You don't have to worry about it. You know you have an item with a value, and all you have to do is put a colon in front of it. And so this is enough to fix the problem. Actually, before I fix the problem, I didn't even show you why it's dangerous. So let me go back. We'll refresh this page, and I'll show you how somebody can exploit the current vulnerability. So if I inspect this button, remember this is the employee number in an HTML attribute, and we saw that was in the query for the report. people that know SQL injection can use a technique called fuzzing. I can't see the end of this. Let's see if that's enough. Fuzzing just means you put in a value, and then maybe you end it, and then you try to do something else, like alter something. And then when you hit the button, you get an error message, but the error message is like a PL SQL error message. And you start to think, ooh, maybe I wasn't supposed to see that. So you refresh and you try again. So this one is a bit worse. What we're doing is ending the empno and then saying execute immediate drop table and then some table name. Now when I click the button, notice the error message here. It says unique or primary keys referenced. What this tells me is that the only reason I could not drop the table is because of a foreign key constraint. But if you know the data model, so that was countries. Countries was referenced by locations. Locations by warehouses, by inventories. Ah, inventories is not being referenced. So what we could do is drop that one. So if I inspect this again, paste in the old value, but then use this table name instead, now the email was sent. If I come back over here and refresh this, inventories is no longer with us. So you get the idea, right? This is really bad. And you can imagine what happened. This value was replaced, I'll paste it in, with this. So this was one statement. It worked fine. This was the next statement. That one dropped the table. Bind variable syntax prevents that. When you use bind variable syntax, Oracle ensures that the value never becomes part of the statement. In fact, the value goes through an entirely different code path. It can never become part of the statement. This is the only secure way to do this in Oracle without a lot of effort. Okay, any questions on this? Let's just make sure that it's working.
No, Dan, no problem.
All right. So now we're getting the type of error we might expect, invalid number, and that's fine. All right. Let's look at another example. Now this page has something unique. If we give it a test, you can see we put in a value for ename. We hit enter, and we see fewer rows. And we can see that it's doing like a fuzzy search for us. If you look at how I put this page together, there is a report on employees. It is a classic report, but more importantly, it's based on a function. Now, why would you create a report based on a function? The idea is that it's more dynamic. You can do more interesting things. And so here, I'm declaring a variable to hold a query. And we start the query here, select star from emp. And here I have conditional logic. If the emp name has a value or is not null, then we append on a where clause. Now, here's the scary thing. You see that I'm using bind variable syntax. So you may think, ah, we're secure, right? Not quite. What Apex does when you use based on a function, it becomes a two-step process. Step one, execute this code to get the query. Step two, execute the query. So by the time Apex gets to step two, the value here is no longer bind variable syntax. It is a string that's being returned. So it's a timing issue here, essentially. So similar kinds of patterns, what people can do is start to fuzz the values coming in here. So what you see here, I'm ending the statement, and then I have this union select star from dual, where dummy like, and then just a single quote. And the error here is really interesting. Ah, incorrect number of columns. Well, the reason for that is that this report has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 columns. But my sub, or union query rather, only has one because it's on dual. So what I can do is start to give more columns. And I can say, let's just go with user. And then null. I think that's enough. Okay. So in this case, what you see is I've only selected one scary value, user. And I got back Apex public user. This is the name of the Apex user that's running. But I don't have to go after a table as innocent as dual. I can select values and data from any table that our parsing schema has access to. This is really, really scary because that will include views oftentimes, such as all users, all tables, this kind of stuff. So we can get information and learn to explore the database that way. Now, if you're thinking, wait, Dan, wait, first of all, we only build Apex applications for internal use. And so we don't expose them to the public internet. It's just who's in our office that can get to them. They're behind the firewall, right? And I don't even know what you're doing here. And I've been using SQL forever. So if I can't do it, surely none of the people we work with can do this either, right? Okay. What if somebody in your office Googles SQL injection tool? The very first thing that comes up is something called SQL Map. SQL Map has a nice, pretty web page with support for different databases, lots of good documentation. By the way, it's also open source and on GitHub. It's a Python-based application. So you clone the repo, which is what I've done over here. I've cloned the repo here. And once you do that, just make sure you have Python installed, and then you can run SQL Map with this command. Now, the interesting thing about SQL Map is it's very easy to use once you know how to get started. And what I have here is essentially a template for SQL Map to hack Apex. So let's focus on just this for a moment. So notice I'm calling SQL Map. The URL, I'm pointing it to an Apex URL. But we need to replace a few values here. So I have these little, what look like substitution strings. The first is for the app ID. And note that I'm hitting on app 100. So we'll paste that in. The next is for the page. The page I want to hack right now is page 2. And then I need the session. So we'll paste that in. The next thing I need is the name of this item that I think may be vulnerable. So I'll inspect it, and I'll get the item name. Okay, now this is the hard one. I need the cookie values. Maybe it's not that hard. I'll go to network, refresh the page, and click on the very first thing. And you'll see that in the request headers, the cookie value I need. So I'll copy and paste that too. Now all I need to do is go to a terminal, paste this in, paste it in the correct directory, and then we'll see SQL Map do its magic. Now, it's already done some basic heuristics, and it's found that the database is Oracle, and because of some of the flags that I used, it's going to town. If you look, again, I said we're running in batch mode, which means command line, and I want you to show me the users, show me the privileges, show me the tables. So it doesn't take too long before we can see all the users, see all the privileges, and see all the tables. I'm just scratching the surface with SQL Map, and you can see what it's doing to get this. So remember when I did the very simple union before? Well, SQL Map knows some really magical unions, and so it's bringing in, I don't even know what this package is, but SQL Map knows, and so it's bringing in all kinds of random values that are known to work for Oracle and getting the information we tell it to get. So please don't think that just because you don't know how to do this that your employees, fellow employees, can't do it. They certainly can.
No sé si sea bueno para los que se perdieron, ¿no? Todo esto que estaba mostrando Dan, es la herramienta es gratis, es fácil de encontrar. No necesita uno saber cómo escribir los queries de SQL Injection. La herramienta lo sabe. Y por medio de parámetros, alguien puede escoger qué información quieren obtener sobre la base de datos. Todo porque se quedó una variable vulnerable a SQL Injection. Una sola es todo lo que necesitan. No necesita que toda la aplicación esté abierta, solo una variable fue la puerta que se quedó abierta.
Gracias. So that is that, and the question then becomes, okay, well, how do we protect in this case? Well, the truth is, we didn't really need the type of region that we're using. Remember, we have this logic here to append in a where clause, and the problem is we're creating a vulnerability. So remember that classic report based on a function is actually very dangerous. Classic report is far safer. And all you have to know is how to write dynamic SQL queries. So in this case, we could have gotten away with a dynamic where clause that is two parts. First part is the ename null. If so, it returns true for the row and continues on. But if ename has a value, then it says, OK, apply this part and filter the row. Now this is proper use of bind variable, and thus we're safe from the value becoming part of the SQL query, because Oracle is guaranteeing that for us. So if I apply that, and remember, this is what we were able to see before with that union, but if I refresh this page now, we don't get any rows back. And if I reran SQL map, it would eventually report to us that the page is not vulnerable. So that's good. So just one more I'll show you here. And we're a little short on time. Are we supposed to end at 5, Monica?
It's 1 hour, but it's okay if you need more time.
Okay, well, I like to stick to the agreed upon times as much as possible anyway, so I won't spend too much time here. But this is just yet another way that people get themselves into trouble. And so now you're thinking, I want to do something fun and creative, right? So what we're doing is giving people the ability to do dynamic reports. So they can come here, they can select a table, and they can basically get whatever report they want, right? So how is something like this implemented? Well, the first item is table, and you'll notice that table has a set list of values. And then there's columns, and columns is based on a SQL query, and its parent is set to table. So whenever table changes, this query will rerun, and we'll get the values based on table. So it looks like we're using a predetermined list, and thus we're safe. But again, I could change the values to whatever I want because I have access to the DOM. So I can come in here and either change values, or I can add options that weren't previously here. And I'll skip showing the vulnerability and skip to showing how to protect against it. And there's two things you need to be aware of when you're writing code that's this flexible. Again, I'm using classic report based on a function, but this is a case where a dynamic where clause is not sufficient, so I have to be more dynamic. But I can still be safe. So the idea is, the first thing I will do is protect the value that comes in to table. So I'll paste in the code that does that. And you'll see all we're doing is saying, if P3 table is not in a predetermined list, the same one that we allowed on render, now we're checking on submit. And if it's not valid, then we raise an error, invalid table. Now, for the columns, you may think, well, that's complex, right? I have to create lists based on the tables, and I have to maintain those. I get it. That's difficult. So there's another solution for that, and it's a package called DBMS Assert. DBMS Assert has validation routines that you can use. So this line right here, where I'm simply trusting the column value. So the column value comes in through the apex item. I get the columns, and then I loop through the columns, creating the column list before I get to the from clause. If I replace this line with a slightly modified version, and this modified version, I'm using DBMS assert. It has a simple SQL name method or function that will return the value passed in, but it will make sure that it's safe to do so. So with those two changes, we've taken a very unsecure process and secured it so that you can get really dynamic without becoming vulnerable when you do.
Dan, if I, bueno, creo que lo voy a decir en español. Si tengo, o sea, este problema solamente me puede suceder si mi lista de valores es estática, ¿verdad? Si tengo una lista de valores dinámica, ¿no va a suceder o puede suceder igual?
Mónica, no sé por qué, pero tu voz para mí no es muy clara. Jorge, ¿escuchaste lo que me preguntó?
Sí, me costó trabajo un poquito. Preguntabas que si la lista es dinámica o que eso solo sucede cuando la lista es dinámica, ¿esa era tu pregunta?
Sí, o sea, que si este problema solamente puede suceder cuando cuando la lista de valores es estática.
Sí, exacto. If you can use dynamic SQL, like dynamic where clause, much better. But sometimes you're doing very dynamic things, and that's where DBMS assert becomes your best friend.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Sí, lo importante de esta llamada de DBMS assert es que se asegura de que el valor que estás usando para una columna de veras sea un nombre para SQL, un nombre sencillo. A diferencia de ser un comando como el que usó Dan antes de drop table. Si tú le pasas algo como drop table, DBMS assert lo va a fallar y va a decir esto no es un nombre sencillo para una columna de SQL. Entonces, y así hay muchas llamadas que tiene DBMS assert. Eso es bueno. Cuando alguien tiene que hacer algo de esta complejidad, es bueno revisar qué está disponible y utilizarlo.
Exacto. You can see some of the other methods as well. And there's even a no-op, which technically doesn't do anything, but it's there if you have a security tool that is flagging something as a vulnerability. You can use the no-op to basically say, we're going to whitelist this. It's safe. We know it is. So, you know, don't flag it anymore.
Sí, como para,
but everything else.
Exacto. No-op significa que no hay operación. Y dice Dan, es para que queda como documentado que en verdad quieres que quede abierto sin seguridad. Si ese es tu caso, si esa es la necesidad, es para que puedas justificar en el código decir, no se me olvidó, lo estoy poniendo con no operación a propósito. Quiero que quede totalmente abierto el valor. Para eso está ahí.
Bueno, ¿hay otras preguntas?
Sí, Dan, ¿por qué no hablas más español? No entiendo.
Es un problema.
¿De dónde es
mío.
Tu esposa, Dan?
¿Está trabajando?
¿De dónde? ¿En dónde nació
mi
tu esposa?
Mi esposa es de Colombia.
Exacto.
¿Y su mamá está aquí ahorita? Bueno, pero nuestra relación empezó en inglés. Y por eso nunca habla español con ella. Pero cuando su mamá está aquí, claro que voy a hablar un poco más en español con ustedes. No sé. Necesito otras maneras como eso para practicarlo.
No hay problema, Dan. No hay problema, te ponemos.
Tiene muy buen español.
La verdad, sí.
Gracias. ¿Y hay alguien aquí de Barranquilla o no?
No.
No. Oh.
De Bogotá, sí, pero de Barranquilla no.
Bueno. Ok, ¿otras preguntas?
Una cosa con César. De pronto lo intentó explicar ahora, pero no lo entendí muy bien. Tengo este escenario. Tengo una lista de valores que se llama sede. Cuando despliego la lista, me muestra la sede de Medellín, Cali, Barranquilla. Cuando yo selecciono la sede Medellín, tengo un campo de texto que le recuerda al usuario cuál es la dirección de la sede Medellín o Barranquilla. Un problema que he tenido es que ese campo es un campo libre, es un campo no asociado a la base de datos y de una forma dinámica, cuando la persona selecciona sede Medellín, le muestra la dirección al usuario, pero para evitar confusión y de que el usuario no digite un dato allí, lo he puesto que sea solo lectura. Pero es una como, o sea, que no sea editable. Pero cuando intento hacer la asignación por una operación dinámica, me dice que hay un error y no lo puedo hacer. Y situaciones parecidas me han pasado en otros formularios para otras aplicaciones, donde yo utilizo un campo libre para mostrar información de otra cosa, pero no me deja modificar desde una acción dinámica.
Sí.
No, no
Hay
puedo,
varias
no.
técnicas. Hay varias técnicas, a lo mejor Dan también va a tener algunas, pero mira, si entiendo correctamente, si el usuario pudiera cambiar esa dirección, no hay ningún daño, ¿correcto?
No
Es
hay ningún
informativo.
daño, es
Exacto.
informativo.
Bueno, entonces yo haría una idea, hay varias formas. Una idea es, quizás sí lo regresaría que fuera un campo de texto, pero usaría CSS, un comando de CSS para que visualmente pareciera que está deshabilitado.
Ah, interesante.
Sí, porque
Que
no
no
hay
sea
daño de
como
código.
un text box, sino que sea como un label.
Que sea un text area, yo creo que sería un campo de text area, quizás, porque es varias líneas, ¿no?, de dirección, pero le aplicamos un color grisáceo o algo vía una regla de CSS para que se vea como deshabilitado.
Interesante ese truco.
Esa sería una idea, porque me estás diciendo que no hay peligro de que el usuario lo cambie, ¿no? La otra posibilidad, permíteme, déjame, estoy checando cómo se llama la opción, a lo mejor no lo voy a poder encontrar en español, pero
Jorge, uno porque, por ejemplo, veamos, muestro la información de un cliente y le doy un botón para confirmar, para terminar de ingresar información de un cliente nuevo, pero cuando le doy regresar, ya no puedo obtener esa información. Es que hay un problema cuando tú llamas un formulario de otro lado y vas a regresar al anterior. Ya hay algo en la seguridad que no me deja copiar en los datos. No sé si de pronto es el manejo del formulario o es un asunto de seguridad. He tenido la inquietud con ese caso
César,
también.
yo creo, porque no estoy segura del ejemplo específico que estás hablando, tiene que ver con el manejo de la sesión. ¿Has validado que la sesión se mantenga?
Que la sesión se mantenga, sí, pero lo curioso es que hay un problema de seguridad que me dice, y de hecho tiene que ver con ese checksum que me toma
Ah,
del
okay.
pelo.
No, entonces lo que tienes que hacer es utilizar la API que se llama Apex Utility Prepare URL, que lo que hace es generarte una URL. Entonces, esa la utilizas y ya no vas a tener el problema. Igual, tienes que pasar el parámetro del checksum, creo que el primer parámetro para este procedimiento, que es URL, y el segundo es cómo quieres manejar el checksum. Entonces ahí puedes utilizar, por ejemplo, session, y él ya te va a permitir abrir esta URL sin problema. Eso es lo que tienes que utilizar.
Oh, interesantísimo. Muchas gracias, Mónica.
Vale.
Sí. Y la otra, podrías sí poner un campo que fuera para la dirección de display only, que creo que es lo que estás usando, pero dile que no lo guarde en session state. Hay un campo donde una bandera que dice sí o no para guardarlo en session state. Creo que en este caso no necesitas guardarlo. Y eso
no.
Eso le quita la protección también.
Oh,
estoy seguro que eso también le quita la protección.
Excelente. Muchísimas gracias.
Okay. Are we all set? Any closing comments from anybody?
No. No more.
Bueno, pues. Gracias, entonces.
Muy buena sesión, Dan. Gracias.
Gracias. Chao a todos.
Muchísimas gracias. Gracias, Mónica, por tu invitación. Gracias a todos.
Bueno, no, solamente falta darle las gracias a Dan porque realmente sentí que habló bastante espacio, se le entendió todo muy bien y solamente voy a practicar un poquito más el español y está listo para el IRAP. Muchas gracias, Dan.
No, de nada. Chao a todos.
Hasta luego.
Thank you.